a big block of delicious cheese ready to be served in little cubes. Does the total mass of the cheese change depending on how you dice it up? In a previous video, we explored the connection between this question and double integrals in two dimensions via Fubini's theorem. The answer was unsurprising. No, the mass should not change. How does this connection generalize to three dimensions? And how many more ways can you dice up your cheese? In this video, you will learn to interpret Fubini's theorem in three dimensions by cutting a block of cheese in many ways. This will build your intuition with triple integrals and reveal the inductive complexity of Fubini's theorem in higher dimensions. Let's describe the question in more formal mathematical terms. Let R be a rectangle in three-dimensional space. Let phi be a bounded, real-valued function on the rectangle R. There are seven kinds of so-called triple integrals. The first kind is the three-dimensional integral, sometimes called the Darboux integral or Riemann integral. This quantity is defined with partitions of R and upper sums and lower sums. The other six kinds are iterated triple integrals, defined using three nested one-dimensional integrals. One example is the dz, dy, dx integral. There are five others depending on the order of integration for dz and dy and dx. But we will focus on this one for now. Before continuing this video, make sure you have had some introduction to these formal definitions. Now, Fubini's theorem gives a sufficient criterion for when these integrals exist and when they are equal. Our main goal is to interpret this theorem in terms of our cheese. We want to pay special attention to how things change from two dimensions to three dimensions. Much will be the same, but some things will differ. By placing this axis, our cheese rectangle can be viewed as a subset of three-dimensional space. Along the x-axis, the rectangle ranges from x equals a to x equals b. Along the y-axis, the rectangle ranges from y equals c to y equals d. Along the z-axis, it ranges from z equals e to z equals f. The cheese is the rectangle R defined as the Cartesian product of these three intervals. For a point x, y, z inside the cheese, interpret the value phi of x, y, z as the density of the cheese at the point. So this varies throughout the space. Mathematically speaking, the function phi may take negative values, but for the sake of the cheese analogy, think of phi as non-negative. The setup of Fubini's theorem in three dimensions starts like it does in two dimensions. For simplicity, we only write out the dz, dy, dx version. The other five versions are all similar. Let R be a rectangle in three dimensions. Let phi be a bounded, real-valued function on the rectangle R. The first assumption is that phi is integrable on R. In other words, the three-dimensional Darboux integral of phi over the rectangle R exists. The interpretation of this assumption closely parallels the 2D case. The three-dimensional Darboux integral corresponds to the true definition for the mass of the cheese. You can think of this as the mass of the unchopped cheese measured all at once on a scale. The mass is 482 grams, so the integral is equal to 482 grams. The second assumption is about x slices. For x in the interval from a to b, define the x slice of phi to be the two-variable real-valued function with domain CD cross EF, which maps the point y, z to the real number phi of x, y, z. Each fixed value of x gives a new two-variable function, so there are infinitely many x slices of phi. Now, Fubini's theorem also assumes that every x slice of phi is integrable. How does this relate to the cheese? An x slice corresponds to fixing a specific value of x and cutting an infinitesimally thin slice of cheese dx. Remember, the word infinitesimal is not used rigorously, but you can think of it as infinitely thin. Think of the width of this x slice as dx. Now, remember the x slice is a function of two variables, namely y and z. I can transport this slice from three dimensions to two dimensions using the y-z plane. Remember, x is fixed and everything is now two-dimensional, with a z-axis here and a y-axis here. For any given point yz, the density of this x slice at yz is equal to phi of x, yz. The third assumption in Fubini's theorem is about xy slices. Fubini's theorem also assumes that every xy slice of phi is integrable on the interval from e to f. In other words, the one-dimensional integral of the xy slice of phi from z equals e to z equals f exists for every fixed choice of x, y in AB cross CD. How does this translate in cheese language? An xy slice can be described with our current x slice in the yz plane. So fix a value of y and cut an infinitesimally thin slice of cheese dy. Now, transport this xy slice into one-dimensional space along the z-axis. For this xy slice of phi, the value phi of xyz corresponds to the mass density at the value z. The integrability of the xy slice on the interval from e to f means that this mass can be computed as a one-dimensional integral of this density. This corresponds to chopping up the slice in many small pieces with infinitesimal length, dz. This piece of the xy slice has density phi of xyz, height dz, length dy, and width dx. So its infinitesimal mass is phi of xyz dz dy dx. Totaling up the contribution of these little cubes, I must integrate along the z-axis to get the integral from e to f of phi of xyz dz times dy dx. This expression corresponds to the infinitesimal mass of our fixed xy slice. Notice the inner integral dz corresponds precisely to the newest assumption in Fubini's theorem. You can interpret this integral as the density of the xy slice itself. Let's transport this one-dimensional xy slice back to the two-dimensional x slice. Recall how this single xy slice has infinitesimal mass given by this integral expression. And this was achieved by chopping up the xy slice along the z-axis.
We can repeat this process for all the other XY slices. Instead of chopping them slice by slice, I'll save time by chopping it all at once.
Different values of y will have different values for this infinitesimal mass. Totaling up all of these slices dy creates the iterated double integral. Here is the key insight. Our 3D Fubini assumptions imply by 2D Fubini that this iterated double integral dz dy exists and is equal to the usual Darboux integral over CD cross EF of the x slice of phi dA. The existence of this two-dimensional integral was one of our assumptions in 3D Fubini. In other words, the total mass of these little dz dy dx cubes will be the same as the mass of the x slice from before. The conclusion of 3D Fubini is all that remains. Assuming phi is integrable on the rectangle, and all the x slices are integrable, and all the xy slices are integrable, Fubini's theorem shows that the iterated triple integral dz dy dx exists and equals the integral of phi on R. The iterated triple integral can be interpreted naturally once again.
Let's transport this two-dimensional slice back to three dimensions. Recall how this single x slice has infinitesimal mass given by this iterated double integral expression. And this was achieved by chopping up the x slice along y and then along z. We can repeat this process for all the other x slices. Instead of chopping them slice by slice, I'll save time by chopping it all at once. dx. Then I will chop it all dy. And finally, I will chop it all dz. Totaling up all of these little cubes corresponds exactly to the dz dy dx integral. In other words, the total mass of these little cubes is the same as the mass from before. So the triple iterated integral is also 482 grams. Revisiting our original question, we have settled the problem for the dz dy dx integral with a version of Fubini's theorem. The same can be done for the other five versions, but the theorem and the chopping is a bit different. We will skip the theorems, since it is only a matter of swapping symbols. Our focus is how different orderings of dz and dy and dx correspond to different ways of cutting the block of cheese.
Let's compare the first slices in three dimensions. We can chop the full 3D block either dx first, or dy first, or dz first. If our first slice was dx, then our second slice can either be dy or dz. This gives two new options. Similarly, if our first slice was dy, then our second slice can either be dx or dz. The same goes if our first slice was dz, then our second slice can either be dx or dy. This gives two new options each, so a total of six options. Let's chop again. Our third slice is automatically chosen in every case. It's the only remaining axis along which we haven't cut. Let's chop till we drop. Under the assumptions of all six versions of Fubini's theorem, totaling these iterated triple integrals will all give the same original total mass of cheese. Unless, of course, you eat some.